Let's turn our attention now to one way ANOVA. ANOVA actually stands for Analysis of Variance. So let's take a look briefly here at the learning objectives, then just jump into what ANOVA is actually all about. Now we want to compare more than two population means using an ANOVA procedure. We want to use a multiple comparison procedure to infer which population is actually different. And we want to be able to identify appropriate parameters to test and compare it based on the data. So these are the main objectives we want to get out of these next several videos. Now, here's the basic idea of what's going on here. If we want to compare means from two independent groups, we typically use a two-sample t-test. That's for the means. Now, obviously, if we have a violation of our assumptions, we jump to Wilcoxon-Rank sum or possibly some other type of non-parametric technique. But what happens if you have three independent groups? Well, if I use all t-tests, I could do a t-test with, say, group 1 versus group 2. Another t-test with, say, group 1 versus group 3. And then another t-test with group 2 versus group 3. Because remember, two-sample t-tests, I can only do two at a time. So I would need three different two-sample t-tests in order to compare three independent groups. Well, that doesn't sound too bad, but what if I have five independent groups? Well, I could take group 1 versus group 2. My next test could be group 1 versus group 3. My next test, group 1 versus group 4. My next test, group 1 versus group 5. Now, my next test, I should go to group 2 versus group 3, and then consider 2 and 4. And then consider 2 and 5. Then I should look at 3 and 4, 3 and 5, and then 4 and 5. See, these are all pairings, two at a time, from five groups. So I end up with 10 different two-sample t-tests. But right away, I can think you can see, if I were to 6 or 7 groups, this gets crazy. Not only does it get crazy, but we need to think of the error rate. What happens to the probability of a type 1 error? Well, if I set alpha at 0.05 for each group, and I'm doing, say, 10 different t-tests, we have a problem. Let's digress for just a minute. Let's suppose I take a coin and I flip it, and it's a fair coin. What's the probability that I get ahead? Well, you know right away that's a half. Then I step over to my right two or three steps. I flip it again. What's the probability I get ahead? Well, it's still a half. I take another couple of steps over to my right and flip it again. And what do I get? Well, a half. Do it one more time. A half. Each time I flip it, I get a half. But suppose I flip that coin four times. What's the probability that I get ahead someplace in those four? Well, we're not going to figure out that probability, but I think you can reason out that it's going to be a lot more than simply a half. And that's the problem up here. If I set alpha to 0.05, it's 0.05 for each of these individually, but what's the probability that somewhere in here I commit a type 1 error? Somewhere I reject a null hypothesis and say that that the groups are different when I shouldn't have. Well, clearly greater than 0.05. Well, what is it? Well, we can figure that out pretty quickly here. If alpha is 0.05, then I can look at this calculation because 1 minus 0.05 is 0.95. So I have 1 minus 0.95. So this is a probability that I don't reject the 0.95. So notice 1 minus 0.95 is 0.05. So if I do this 5 times, I have 1 minus 0.95 to the fifth. Well, if you grab a calculator, that's something to the effect of 0.2261 or 62, something like that. I think it's like 621, 21, something to that effect. It doesn't matter. The point is, this family error rate, if I can call it that, or there's a group error rate for all of these guys, would be close to 22%. So rather than having a 5% chance of type 1 error, I now have a 22, almost 23% chance of a type 1 error. And is this acceptable? Well, obviously no way. I mean, that's bad. That's a serious issue there. So one way that we deal with this is to use and ANOVA. ANOVA technique allows us to make comparisons between, I'm going to say, many independent groups, where many here, we would use ANOVA for really more than two groups. Specifically, we're going to be working with a technique called One Way ANOVA. And the reason that we call it One Way ANOVA is because the data has multiple levels of the same variable. We're only dealing with one variable, but that variable has different levels within it. That may make a little bit more sense when we actually jump into an example. Now remember, ANOVA stands for Analysis of Variance. I'm not going to get into here the details of ANOVA. Take a look at your textbook because that breaks it down and breaks down the logic behind ANOVA. But really, in a nutshell, it takes a look at the variability within each group, and then it compares it with the variability compared to the entire group if we put them all together. That's essentially what this thing is doing. And actually, ANOVA is really, because I'm comparing the two variabilities, it's really nothing more than an F-test, but it combines the variances from all these groups together in kind of a slick mathematical way. Again, the textbook will go into more detail about the logic behind ANOVA, but suffice it for right now to just think in terms that ANOVA is comparing these different variabilities. Now, the assumptions for ANOVA, you know, everything, every technique we have has assumptions. The first assumption is that each sample was randomly and independently selected from the population it represents. It's representative of the population is really what this is getting at, the population that each sample is representing. And this is kind of a standard assumption that we always assume. If we don't think our data is somehow representative of the population we're trying to represent, then why are we doing an analysis? So this is kind of an assumption really for everything that we do, like I said. The next one, the parent distributions, the populations I'm talking about. When I use the term parent distributions, I'm talking about the populations, are all normal. We saw this in two-sample t-test. Well, go back to the one-sample t-test. The assumption is that the population we sampled from was normal. So we said, well, we needed X to be distributed normal, and then talked about the CLT and how X bar distributed normal, how that worked, and so forth for the one-sample t. Well, it's the same sort of an idea here. And that when we jump to two sample T, we needed both populations to be normal. Now we have three, four, or five, so we need all the populations to be normal. And if we're going to use the CLT, if the CLT applies, we have to have the CLT apply for all the groups. We're not going to mix and match here. We're not going to apply the CLT to group one and then look at a normal plot for group two and you know, that sort of a thing. It's either we're going to look at all normal plots or CLT applies everywhere. The last assumption is that the variance of the case samples are all equal. When we say equal, really we're talking about similar. And see, we already did this. We already did this with the two-sample T. We checked to see if the two variances were similar or not, and that told us whether we're going to pool. But, well, what happens on the ANOVA, remember I said earlier that it takes a look at the variability of each individual group, and then it compares it with the variability amongst the entire group, put them all together. What it does is it pools the variances automatically. That's part of the ANOVA. So in order to do that, you need to make sure that it's safe to pool to begin with. And what we're going to do is we'll do an F-test. We can satisfy this subsumption with an F-test, like I said a moment ago, just like we did on the two-sample T. But now because we have more than one group, more than one sample, the F-test we based on the largest and the smallest variance. So in other words, we'll see it in the example here, but the null hypothesis would be that the variance of whatever the largest group is divided by the variance of whatever the smallest variance is equals 1, hence similar. Then the alternative would be not equal. And it doesn't matter if you have the largest on top or the smallest on top because we're going to have equal. And then the alternative hypothesis, let me scribble it right here. Largest over the smallest will be not equal to 1. Well, because it's not equal to tailed, it doesn't really matter if you have the largest or smallest on top. It doesn't matter at all. So let's go ahead and from here jump in and take a look at an ANOVA example.